My book, Sex, No Drugs, and Rock and Roll, Memoirs of a Music Junkie, is in two parts. Part one is the 50s and 60s, primarily the 60s, right. And part two is the 70s. Tell me, let's start with you in the 60s.
Okay.
What were you doing in the 60s?
In the 60s, I was working for an office manufacturing company as a salesperson after college. Got bored out of my mind. I hung around the village, and all of a sudden, I go into all these clubs, the Bitter End, it was called the Cotton Bull then, and see these amazing acts rehearsing, Peter, Paul, and Mary, or, you know.
And it was called what before it was called?
Cock and Bull.
Cock and Bull. Right. That, was Colby involved then?
Oh, no. Way later, it's way before. This
okay.
Fred Weintraub owned it with Manny Roth, who also owned the Cafe Wa.
Okay.
They were partners.
Okay.
Then Manny got tired of the club. He was, you know, and Fred bought it from him, and he renamed it the Bitter End, mainly because it was like the last stop on Bleecker Street before you got to the Bowery, which was the Bitter End.
right.
It was actually not the last stop. The last stop was a club called the Dugout. Well, that's like an old wine, old place, you know.
Right.
So, you know, I gave up my job because I met a girl. Always, you know, how it's always
right.
A story, you know.
Right.
Good planning, right? And she invited me down to the Bitter End, and I bumped into her on the street one night, and she said, "Come on in, we need an MC. I said, "Great, I'll take it." It ended up, they needed a doorman. So I said, "Great, I'll take it." I took it. And from that point on, you know, I just got to know a lot of the acts, people like John Denver and Chad Mitchell and, oh, Mike Settle and Kenny Rogers. I mean, it's crazy, right?
Right.
Then I got to become a manager of a number of acts. I discovered, you know.
And now, when did Colby come in?
In 68,
I
left the Bitter End. I was managing
Harris and Jeff Walker.
So he might have been there on 69.
I remember.
Right,
66.
Right,
you're right. Now, did they have Hootin' Any Nights back then?
Of course, every Tuesday.
Every Tuesday.
Every Tuesday, right.
Because I think it was Monday and Tuesday were the Hootin' Any Nights that I remember.
Tuesday.
Going around with my guitar.
So then I discovered Barry Manilow and Emmylou Harris and Jerry Jeff Walker, became their manager, left the Bitter End. Paul. There was another guy before Paul.
Fuckle.
Yeah, came in for a while. Then Paul came in. Then I went back and joined Fred Weintraub's management company. It was called Fredana Management. And
that was the Mercer Arts Center
yeah.
there at the time?
Yeah, it was there already. It maybe had collapsed already by that time. But yeah, it was there. It was a great spot.
My memories of the village at that time was there was kids everywhere with guitars going
crazy.
From place to place. Any stories, anything you remember that specifically stands out in your mind a little bit?
I want to tell you the story. So when I was a doorman at the Bitter End, and once in a while we'd have an opening act, right?
Right.
So I would run over to the clubs and see who was available. You know, like I would go over to Gertie's Folk City, and Jose Feliciano would be there. I'd follow him to the men's room. He and his dog and me, both peeing at the And I said, Jose, you want to open a set for the Bitter End? I can pay you $10. And he said, yeah. So he would follow me over with his wife, Hilda, and the dog. Or I'd get Richie Havens or, I should have a couple of guys are famous actors right now.
Right.
See him walking in the streets and, hey, come on, let's come and do an opening set. You know,
right.
Because we always had three acts. It was a folk singer, a comedian, and then the main act.
Right.
So every once in a while, the opening act would be missing, right? So, and that's how it segued into the Coffee House Circuit.
Tell me about the Coffee House Circuit.
The Coffee House Circuit was a joint venture with Fred Weintraub and the Bitter End, and the NAC, which was the National, NEC.
NEC.
National Entertainment Council Conference.
Yeah, that was from colleges, right?
Yes, yeah. It was big, you know.
Yeah.
So we'd have a student activities director, let's say at RPI in Troy, New York. And she would be responsible for six or seven of the schools in New York, like the SUNY schools, right? We'd hire somebody like Harry Chapin or Jim Croce or whatever to do, this is how it would work. First, I had to do an audition for us, right? And we'd have, you know, auditions once a year.
Right.
And we'd invite all the buyers, all the school people in. So they would go to one school for 3 days, and they would get $100 for the first man, and every additional man in the group, an additional $75, plus room and board, plus gas allotment, which was figured on where the next school was. So they'd be 3 days, they'd stay in the dormitory with the kids, they'd eat with the kids, The Wednesday they would go to the draft to the next school, which might be, let's say, from RPI to SUNY Albany or whatever. Do three more days, and they could do, and they could work for maybe 50 weeks of the year. I mean, it's amazing for these guys because they would make a living, and not a bad living, right? If you make $300 a week per person or something like that.
Now, I remember the NEC used to have these big conventions for all the buyers. Did that happen after the coffee house?
That probably happened at the same time. We would go down to Washington, D.C., and would have we would be part of their conference as well. But that was mostly to showcase our acts down there in Washington, you know, in D.C. They made a grab for the company after, you know, we weren't making any money. We were doing a great service for the schools. We were doing a great service for the artists. It was costing us a fortune. We charged every school a fee to join, and then we ran the company, you know, and all the expenses are, had like two people working, plus myself. So what we decided, we wanted to charge the artists a small commission. The NEC got all up in arms, and they said, well, we can do it ourselves, and they took it over in less than a year.
And that was the end of it.
Yeah, of course, you know.
Where'd you go from there?
Well, working at the club, then I went on my own to manage the acts.
Right.
Then I went back to Fred Wandrum. I ran his publishing company for Nana Management.
Right.
Music. And I worked co-managing Jerry Jeff Walker, who I brought into their company. Then I met, I met Michael Sukin, who was Lou Levy's son, mm-hmm. down at the Bitter End. And he said, hey, why don't you come and do some publishing with us at Leeds Music, you know? Mm-hmm. So it sounded great, you know, and I was going to do that. And then I told Fred, you know, I'd bring Fredana's publishing in with Lou. Fred was in the midst of doing a film with Universal, Woodstock film, right?
Right.
So Sal Chianti, who was the head of MCA Music and probably the number one publishing guy in the world.
I remember Sal.
Yeah. He said, hey, Fred, bring the thing in with us, you know, while you're doing films with Universal. And Neil Diamond, who was managed by Fredana, was on Deck. It wasn't called Deck at the time. They started a new label for him. It was in a Universal MCA. So.
Right.
So I ended up going up into MCA Music and running that publishing company. And
out of there.
Yeah, it was great. It was a great experience. All of a sudden, I'm above 14th Street. Like, I'm the...
You're out of the village. Oh, my God.
Some people, I used to say, you know, when I was managing execs, like, wow, when am I going to meet somebody in business above 14th Street? Now I'm the guy that people say, hey, we know a guy...
Now, wait a second. Where was Max's Kansas City? Was that above 14th Street or below?
It was... I think a block or two above.
Above 14th Street.
Square, yeah,
okay.
18th, yeah, right, that's right.
Now, do you have any memories of Max's? What is
yeah,
the best
sure.
of Max's?
Yeah,
talk to me a little bit.
When I signed Kinky Friedman to Vanguard Records,
uh-huh.
and we did a showcase with Kinky,
uh-huh.
which was, I'm not even going to say some of the jokes that he, they weren't appropriate for a New York audience.
Okay, maybe appropriate for my book, I'll tell you that. Go ahead.
Anyway. Billy Joel was the opening act. I had no idea who the hell Billy Joel was. Well, he was nobody at the time.
Right,
he was Billy Joel, but
right,
you know.
Right.
So, and I didn't even know he was the opening act until my ex-partner told me that many years ago. So, by the way, you know, you were Kinky Friedman at Max's Kansas City. Billy Joel was the opening act. I think he played Piano Man also. So I stayed at MCA. Well, here I go again. Right?
That's okay. Yeah, that's right. No problem.
So I stayed at MCA Music for 3 years. Got married. My wife was a receptionist there. And then Richard Goddard and Seymour Stein asked me to come over at Sire Records. It was just started to happen as a more like a folky, bluesy label, right?
Yeah.
So I left MCA Music uh-huh. and went with Seymour and Richard. And it was an interesting...
Now, Sire was still doing folky acts. They didn't go to they didn't go to the Ramones or anything at
correct.
That point.
Well, I went over there like 1971.
So it was early 70s.
Yes.
Okay, now we're moving into the 70s, a part two from my book. Now, at part two, I was a writer for Beachwood Music, and then I was doing an off-Broadway musical, and then I started working with Tom and Vince.
My buddies, Vince.
Contemporary Productions. Yeah, now, tell me some stories about, what do you remember about
that? I can't tell. Vince was quite a character. Vince was managing Larry Coryell,
right.
who I signed to Vanguard Records.
Right.
And so I brought Vince into the Vanguard offices because Vanguard didn't spend money in marketing and promotion, right?
Uh-huh.
So I thought Larry needed a marketing guy, a radio guy.
Right.
So I said, here, Vince, take this office and just call everybody, call radio stations, press, do whatever you can. They didn't know, you know, how to market this
right,
thing.
Right.
So about 8 months later, Maynard Solomon, who was one of the presidents, came over to me and says, this is 8 months after, or maybe 7 months, Dave, there's a guy that's been working here in the back office. You know who he is? I said, yeah, he's Larry Coryell's manager. And so that worked out good, you know.
Because with Tom and Vince, and they would book me as an opening act for the Braid and for Oregon and for the various acts that they put in the various clubs at the time.
He had his own office at the time. Right?
Yeah, yeah, and I was
Broadway.
Yeah. Well, it was, yeah, it was a 59th Broadway, actually. Right. That was after 57th Street. Then right. He came down there. And, yeah, we have some interesting memories from back then. I was playing Gertie's, I was playing the Bitter End, I was playing all those places opening, and then I started working with Tom and Vince doing the management situation. Then I got involved with Jerry Ragavoy, the Hit Factory. He signed me. And I started to record with Jerry, and I started various, and it's all in the book. but anyway, take me from there, from the 70s. Now, what happened with you at that point? You were doing Vanguard.
Right.
Then where did you go from there?
Okay, so after about 75, I had a disagreement with Vanguard. I had signed two very successful acts, although they weren't super successful, then Dave Loggins and Kinky Friedman. And Kinky was sold to Dunhill Records for a lot of money. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I didn't get anything. I was very disappointed. And I told Maynard Solomon that Dave Loggins was recording a song called Please Come to Boston. And we had a... This is before it was sold. We had to give him another $3,000, $4,000 to do another mix on it. And Maynard, being a folky or whatever, didn't want to do it. So I was really disappointed, and I decided to leave.
Now, Please Come to Boston was a number one hit, wasn't
yes,
it?
Yeah, on Epic, though.
Yeah, on Epic.
But it was recorded under my jurisdiction, you know.
So where'd you go from there?
So went out on my own. I became a partner with Charlie Benanti. And we had a very nice management company, Michael Urbaniak, Josh White Jr., Tom Paxton, Richie Havens.
I said, one of the things I remember about the 70s in the Village was CBGB's, which originally supposed to be Country, Bluegrass, and Blues.
Right.
That didn't happen.
Never saw one of those.
Never happened, right. What do you remember about CBGB's?
The toilet seats. or no toilet seats.
No toilet seats.
No doors. The place was disgusting.
CBGB's in the punk scene changed everything as far as music for me. I couldn't play anymore. I mean, there were very few places. Everything started to change. At the same time, you had disco happening as well. And so you had the disco and punk situation in the late 70s, mid to late 70s,
right.
And it changed everything for me. How about you?
Well, I didn't like that scene at all because I was used to working with people who crafted their songs, who knew how to play their instruments. You know, might have been playing 10, 15 years. And, you know, these were great artists, where the punk scene was a bunch of kids who maybe played for 3 months and then put a band together and had this look, and it was more about that look and their attitude. So I was really unhappy about that. However, you know, it did open up music to a lot of kids, and a lot of kids bought guitars and basses and stuff.
Oh, yeah, it was great for the music manufacturing guys. I mean, they could sell all these guitars and drums, and people couldn't play them, but they... Anyway,
so out of that whole bunch, though, there were a few that did come out.
Well, Seymour signed the Ramones,
right.
And they did very well.
Right.
And there was Joan Jett, and there were
a bunch of them that are still doing good,
that are still making music. And you
right.
can't knock that music. But on the other hand, boy, that was a difficult time for me as well.
Yeah, I didn't like it, but I did get involved in the late 70s in the disco area, the dance area.
Now, what do you remember? I think I did a little bit in the book about Eddie O'Loughlin and Mid-Song Records and Bob Reno. Any stories about Eddie?
Well, yeah, and Bob too.
Okay. give me a little bit on that. What do you remember about those guys?
Well, I replaced Bob at Vanguard Records. Bob was the head of A&R, and they let him go and they hired me.
Uh-huh.
Of course, he was such a spendthrift that he basically spent the entire budget. So I was, again, in a place on a shoestring, right? But I did fine. I got a lot of hits for Vanguard.
Now, did he then set up Mid-Song after
yeah.
that with Eddie?
Yes, yeah. And Eddie always was a great music guy and knew great songs. And I remember going up there and seeing Eddie and Bob, and there was John Travolta sitting around. As you know, he was signed to them.
Right.
So they had a quick run with these pop songs that Bob likes and Eddie likes.
Then I wrote about Carol Douglas and what they did with the disco and how that
Right.
That started a whole new situation. Now, what do you remember about the disco situation?
Well, I actually signed Carol Douglas later on to a label I started with Danny Weiss called Shanaki Cachet. I started Cachet Records, made a deal with Shanaki. It became Shanaki Cachet. And we actually did quite well in the dance area, but with the jazz influences, because that was Danny Weiss's real...
Danny was really a jazz guy.
And a great producer, right. So we did some wonderful records, including Carol Douglas, Noel Pointer. Well, Noel was... We did the smooth jazz things, which also became big in the early...
Was it late 70s still?
Yeah, it was more like Quiet Storm in those days, right? Mm-hmm, so, and WBLS had a Quiet Storm program. And yeah, so that was a record label that I started with Danny, and it was distributed through Koch, which, you know, and they saw how well we did, and then I had a bit of a problem with my partners.
Now tell me something. Happened, right? Is Koch Records part of the Koch Brothers? Now tell me something.
Happened, right?
Is Koch Records part of the Koch Brothers, the wealthy Koch? Because it's spelled the same way.
It's pronounced differently, though. That's Koch and their Coke.
You're sure it's not the same?
Oh, definitely not.
Oh, good.
I mean, Michael Koch, you know, I work with him every day. Because then we started a record label, and that's when Bob Frank got involved. And
right.
Started, and then I went, you know.
Yeah, because Bob Frank is now putting out some of the Bottom Line series for Alan Pepper, which we discussed when I talked to him recently.
Right. So from starting this label with Shanaki, I mean, nobody knew what Shanaki was. Maybe a bunch of Irish musicians knew what it was. It's an Irish. But in my world, well, in most worlds, nobody knew what the hell Shanaki was.
Now, you said Irish musicians. Immediately, then I remember Pat Kenny and Kenny's Castaways.
Right.
Do you have any good stories about Kenny's Castaways? You remember Kenny's Castaways?
Yeah, I remember him great when he was up on 85th Street.
Yeah, up on the Upper East Side.
And I had Jerry Jeff Walker play up there, and a whole bunch of...
Because I played there, and then there was a place called Brandy's up there.
Brandy's, right. I think I saw you...
You did see me play there,
yes.
I think, yeah.
Oh, that was on the Avenue, right?
Yeah.
Holy mackerel, that's great.
And then Pat Kenny moved down to the Village
when
NYU was redoing the whole area there, and he moved Kenny's Castaways down there.
Almost next to the Bitter End.
Yeah, right. And he had the Irish Rovers whenever they were in town.
Really great bunch of guys.
Yeah. So then from the jazz scene there, from doing the label situation, then did you move more into management after that? What happened after that?
No. Like I said, I had a disagreement with the guy who owned Shanaki. It was about paying royalties to one of the acts that I had signed there.
Uh-huh.
It was due royalties.
He needed royalties and he wasn't getting them.
And so they bought me out, and I called up Danny Goldberg, who was the president of Atlantic Records at the time.
Right? And he'd done Gold Mountain yet?
Oh, he had Gold Mountain way before that, yeah. And he did go back to Gold Mountain as well, but Danny had left. He was bought out of his position at Atlantic Records. Doug Morris had left. And I told Danny that, hey, I know an act out of Seattle by the name of Laura Love who's great. So he said, all right, let's go out and see her. So she was playing in Indianapolis, and we flew out to Indianapolis, and he flipped out over her, you know. And then at that hotel that night, he got a call from his lawyer saying that the position of president of Mercury was offered to him.
Really?
So he took it. I was actually the first guy he hired, although he hired me as more of a consultant.
Uh-huh.
But, you know, it was a real hire.
At Mercury.
Yes, and we signed Laura Love. You know, that's like that.
Cool.
Basically, I was his first signing.
Oh,
first,
cool.
That was really cool. We did really nicely with Laura. In those days, you know, if you sold 70 or 80,000 records, that was okay. It wasn't great.
Now today,
that's
you 70,000 records.
Right.
Great.
Right. She was really unique, and I had seen her at Carnegie Hall. And I was hanging out with Aztec Two-Step, Neil.
Uh-huh.
And Neil was playing that night. So he said, Dave, just send my wife out of these tickets, keep her company. So I said, okay, so go up. So, and also I see Laura perform. She comes out with a bass player, and she's dancing, clogging as well.
So it was backstage in Carnegie Hall?
No, we're sitting in the seats above it. I was sitting in the seats with Neil.
From Aztec Two-Step.
His wife.
Okay, so go ahead.
So Neil's asking me, I guess he hadn't gone on yet, or he had gone on, and he came back to sit with us. And he said, Dave, what do you look for as an A&R guy? And I said, I can't really put my finger on it, but I know it when I see it. All of a sudden, Laura Love comes on stage. I said to Neil, that's what I look for. And I ran back after the stage and met her and introduced myself. And after about 2 years, I finally signed it.
All right, now tell me more about now. That's enough for the past. What are you doing now, David? What are you up to now?
So right now, I'm living in Florida.
Yeah, with where we are right now, in your kitchen. Right.
Trying to cut back a little bit, okay, you know, because I just don't really enjoy what's out there as well. So I was invited to Ottawa for the Ontario Council of Folk Festivals. And I was watching the showcase, and actually brought my wife up that nice weekend. And she saw this band on stage, the Sultans of String. I gave my card. They gave my card to their Canadian manager, Lisa Weitz. And she said, wow, you really should talk to Dave. He's got a lot of, you know. So anyway, I'm managing them. I'm the U.S. manager. Lisa is their Canadian manager. We work together.
What's happening with them now?
Oh, they're on their, they're just coming out with their fifth album. Everything these guys do is interesting. That's why I'm working with them like 5 or 6 years, right? And I also manage a young woman who's a great musician by the name of Heather Pearson. And she's a great singer, great songwriter, great musician, you know. And I saw her in the hotel lobby playing piano, and I went over to her and said, wow, you really, I had no idea she was a singer or a songwriter. Mm-hmm. Then when she gave me the CD, I'm driving home that next day, I said, whoa, cool. So I handled her, and I still handle on and off various Canadian clients.
Okay, so you're still a busy boy.
Yeah, cool. Busy.
Well, thanks much for doing this with me. I appreciate sitting down with me and going through all this.
Yeah,
as I said, it'll be up on my website for the book. The book, Sex, No Drugs, and Rock and Roll, Memoirs of a Music Junkie. I don't know where the camera is. But thanks again, David.